So today, we've been studying for the last 6 or 7 weeks already now, different ideas, excuse me, on positive psychology and how to bring a more happy living into our life based on principles that are found both in the Torah and reflected in modern psychological research. This series has been based on the work of the great book, Life in the Balance, written by Rabbi and Dr. Pelkovitz, father and son team. I recommend you buy it. It's something worth reading over on a monthly basis if you have the time, if you're so inclined. And today we're going to talk about another very, very important component of happiness, and that is forgiveness and conflict resolution. So the way in which we resolve the problems that come up between us and other human beings has a very large effect on our overall happiness. If we cannot come to conflict resolution, and we cannot come to that place of mutual understanding, we often find ourselves mired in anger and resentments, and unable to move forward. However, we're able to come to the right place of forgiveness, and asking for forgiveness, then we are able to increase our happiness by about 23%. And that number was made up literally on the spot. I want to just break for a quick word from our sponsor, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Shehakol Niyeh B'Dvaro. God not only makes the best water, but makes the best people too. So, anyway. So a lot of studies have shown that people who are unable to let go, unable to forgive, holding on to resentments and anger, are at a significantly higher risk for depression, health problems, and even premature death. That's a pretty remarkable thing. You know, you go to a funeral, and they say, "Ah, here lies Bob Whitfield, taken at such a young age by resentment." It's like, you don't usually hear that. Or, you know, "Oh, I don't know if you heard, but Bob's is kind of sick right now. He's on his deathbed. Really, what's wrong with him? What, you know, does he have cancer? I don't know. He just has a lot of resentments. A lot of resentments." It's hard to imagine that, but that is a reality. The reality is that when we hold on to all that anger and bitterness inside, it affects us not just psychologically, but even physically. It crosses the divide. You know, just like, unfortunately, cancers can metastasize. So a person can get lung cancer, and it starts in their lung, and then unfortunately it can spread to different parts of their body, and there's nodules of it in different parts springing up. This resentment and anger is like a cancer, which starts with one specific scenario, but then literally just starts taking over, moving across the barrier from the emotional to the physical, and taking a deep toll, not just on our emotional well-being and our happiness, but onto our physical life as well. They find that people who hold on to anger, if you go, just give them a blood pressure test, they have higher pulse rate, they have higher blood pressure. "Oh, you're taking statins, you have high cholesterol?" No. I just hold on to my resentments and my blood pressure is skyrocketing, so I'm on blood pressure medication. Oh, okay. The idea is that it is a necessary component of life to be able to let go. Now, what's fascinating, though, is... Hold on a second. I think I lost a page over here. Or did I? Yes, I did, but it's not here. Unless it's right behind this one. Yes. Now, when it comes to Jewish understanding, we have a very sort of different approach than the Western Christian world. The Christian world, when dealing with the offenses of someone else, recommends that you, does anybody know the phrase? Turn the other cheek. Very good. If you look up the actual source, which I did, it's in Matthew 5, right? Matthew 5, I think, is 29 or 39. I actually looked it up. It was like weird. It was my first time actually looking up Christian scripture. But I'm so curious, because you always hear this phrase, turn the other cheek. So I looked it up, and basically what it says is if someone bops you across the face, you know, turn the other cheek so he has a fresh cheek to hit next time. And if he gets your, you know, sues you and gets, I don't think sues there means like sues in court, but like he gets your shirt from you, give him your pants. It's kind of like this automatic forgiveness, you know, Jesus died for our sins and he just forgave us unconditionally, therefore we should forgive everybody else unconditionally and give them the other cheek. They must be suffering inside if they're hitting you and lashing out at you. So just be understanding and give them another target. That is definitely, definitely not the Jewish perspective when it comes to forgiveness. The responsibility to ask for forgiveness is definitely placed on the transgressor. It's not the victim being told immediately, just go ahead, turn the other cheek, just forgive. No, you were offended. You shouldn't just forgive. The responsibility is on the person who hurt you to ask for forgiveness. The Talmud says that even in a case where, for example, let's say we got in a fight and I got so angry that I smashed you in the cheek, just to use a common example that we just... So I actually owe you money. By Jewish law, I owe you money for the pain that I inflicted upon you, right? So we got into a fight and we're arguing, Trump, Hillary, and I'm really, I can't believe it, bam, smack you across the face in front of everybody here. And it's a smarting blow. Ah, it hurts. I gotta pay you for the damages. If God forbid I hit you in a different way and I broke your arm or something and now you're out of work, I gotta pay you for missed work. But even more, by Jewish law, I have to pay you for the embarrassment. I have to pay you for the embarrassment. And how do you determine how you pay somebody for embarrassment? Well, it depends what the situation was. Who hit who? In front of what crowd? So the courts assess the damages and they say, okay, the pain for a slap, we'll call that $100, right? It was $50. I would take a slap for 50, right? It's not exactly how it's judged, but yeah, I'll take a slap for 50. But and now we move to the next category, slaps for 200. But then there's the embarrassment. That can be significantly more. I would definitely pay a lot more than $50 to avoid being embarrassed in front of this prestigious crowd. So the courts assess the fee for the embarrassment at $400. $450. $50 for the pain. $400 for the embarrassment, there's no loss of work, there's no doctor bills. Okay, so I go over to the guy and I give him $450. It's not over yet. The Talmud says you're not finished. You've paid for your damages, but you still have not asked for forgiveness. And you have a requirement. Even though you've paid, you've, so to speak, financially made good on what you did wrong, you still are not done. You still are chayav. You are obligated to ask the person for forgiveness. Maimonides, when talking about repentance, says that even though Yom Kippur is this incredible day of atonement, it can only atone for things that you did to God. It can't atone for the things that you did wrong to your friend. You have to ask your friend forgiveness. What if your friend says no? Well, you ask him again and you bring friends along with you. You have to put real effort. By Jewish law, you've got to put real effort into asking forgiveness. It's not just like a one-time thing. Well, I asked him for forgiveness and he said no. What else do you want me to do? I'll tell you what else I want you to do. I want you to go back with other friends who will vouch for you that you seriously regret what you did and try to help convince him. And then you go back again. You have to go three times with friends and different friends, really trying to show that you are putting in every effort you can to properly ask for forgiveness. And if by the third time the guy still doesn't forgive, then the blame starts to go back on him. Which brings us to another thing. I have an obligation to ask for forgiveness. But if you see that I'm truly, legitimately asking for forgiveness and putting in the effort, you are supposed to forgive. Now it's interesting, when describing the asking of forgiveness in halachic literature, in Torah literature, they frequently use two languages, something called pius and ritzoi. Pius is emotionally. I have to reach out, and understand how I emotionally hurt you and try to soothe those emotions. Did I hurt your sense of pride? Did I betray you and now you feel betrayed? In my language and asking for forgiveness, I have to be talking to those emotions. Betrayal. Hurt sense of worth. But then there's also something called Ritsoi. Ritsoi is more of a cognitive process. I may have changed your perspective on your own abilities by making fun of you. And you were trying to, you came in and you told me, yeah, you know, I'm just starting this college, I'm doing really well, I think I'm going to shoot for the dean's list. I'm like, yeah, dean's list? That's for smart people. I may have cognitively changed the way you view yourself. Now I need to work on that as well. But if I do that, again, the harmed party is supposed to accept. The Rambam explains like this. The Rambam, Maimonides, says, the harmed party is not allowed to be cruel and deny forgiveness. It's not the way of the people of Israel. Rather, once the offender pleads for forgiveness several times, and it is known that he has repented regarding his sin and reconsidered his evil ways, forgiveness should be granted. This is not somebody who's in prison and he wants clemency, so he says, oh yeah, I asked the family of the victim three times. You know, this is not, we're not talking about that. We're talking about normal situations. A husband says something offensive to his wife, a wife says something offensive to her husband. Two friends from the same synagogue, someone got offended by something you said to them at a kiddush. Once the offender pleads for forgiveness several times and it is known that he's repented regarding his sin, he's not making fun of you anymore. It wasn't just a one-time situation where he sometimes feels bad for a few moments that he did something and then he asked forgiveness, but he's going to do it again. But no, he really truly stopped. One is supposed forgiveness should be granted. Anyone who is quick to forgive is praiseworthy. And our sages were pleased with such behavior. We see this in the Torah. It says, Lo sisna esachicha bilvavecha, you shall not hate your brother in your heart. Lo sikom velo sitar, you shall not take revenge, nor shall you bear a grudge against the children of your people. Ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha, ani Hashem, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself, I am Hashem. So what's the difference between revenge and grudge? So Rashi famously says, the difference between revenge and grudge is like this. It's snowing outside. There's 8 inches of snow. And my neighbor, I see him, he's working, he's shoveling his snow. He's got this great shovel, this brand new fiberglass, carbon glass, plexiglass, whatever it is. And it's got this deep thing, and it's got the kink in the handle. Who knows what? There's all sorts of issues there. This is what we need. So after he's finished shoveling, I know he's been working hard. I wait a few minutes and wait for him to have his hot chocolate inside. And I come knocking at his door and I say, hey, Bob, I'd like to borrow your shovel. I said, you've got a great shovel. Can I borrow your shovel? And he says, no. That's it. You know, sometimes people say, like, no, but there's a whole excuse. He doesn't say it. He just says, no. You're like, wait, if you're like, explain it? No. You sure I can't borrow your shovel? Yep. And he's waiting there, uncomfortable silence. Goes on for about 7 seconds. You're like, okay, see you later. But you go back home and you're kind of angry. Why didn't he let you borrow his shovel? I don't know. Okay, so you take out your other rinky-dink shovel. You only have your gardening shovel, which is not made for shoveling snow. It's made out of metal, and it's like this thin. It's got a pointed edge. And you sit there, and it takes you 8 hours to shovel your driveway. The next day, when you're sick with pneumonia, you're sitting at home trying to nurse your echinacea tea, and There's a knock at the door. Who is it? It's Bob. And Bob says, "Hey, Lamy, I know you've got that really good tool set. I saw you building your sukkah back in the warm era of October. Can I borrow your drill?" Now, what do you want to say?
Nope.
No explanation needed. Nope. The Torah says you shall not take revenge. That would be taking revenge, right? He didn't let you borrow his shovel. Now you don't let him borrow your drill. So you're like, okay, I got to give it to him. The Torah says. So you go downstairs, you go get the drill, and as you're coming up, you're thinking of all the wise things that you're going to say. Oh yeah, by the way, I'm like of the lending neighbor kind, you know? Do you know that kind? The lending neighbor kind? You're going to say all these lines like, oh yeah, of course I would lend you my drill. That's what neighbors are supposed to do, lend stuff to each other, right? But that would be called bearing a grudge. The Torah says you can't do that either. That, of course, is what leads to v'haftol re'acha kamocha, when I don't have that experience. So Rashi says that revenge is when I do to somebody what they did to me, or an approximation of that. Bearing a grudge is where I give the guy my drill, but I say to him a line. Of course I would lend you my drill. I'm a nice guy, and I lend stuff to my neighbors. However, the Sefer HaChinuch, the Book of Education, which lists, an anonymously written book, and it lists all 613 commandments, he goes even a step further. He says, taking revenge is when you do something back to somebody. He says, bearing a grudge is when you harbor it in your heart. See, Rashi said bearing a grudge is when you say something back to the guy. You give the guy your drill, but you say something to him. The Sefer HaChinuch takes it one step further. He says, you're not a bearer of grudge. You're not allowed to even harbor ill will in your heart against him. Which is a lot harder. Definitely a lot harder to come to a place of forgiveness in your heart. So how do we come to that place of forgiveness? How do we remove all that evil, vile, bile, anger, bitterness that's sticking inside of us and not letting us let go? So if we look at the word mechila, which is forgiveness in Hebrew, we're going to see two different concepts emerge. The word machol in Hebrew can mean a circle. Asid HaKadosh Baruch Hu lasos machol latzadikim. God in the future will make a circle for the tzadikim, for the righteous. The HaKadosh Baruch Hu yoshev b'neim, and God sits amongst them in the middle, and they dance around him, and they say, this is the God that we awaited. That's a machol, that's a circle. It's not exactly grammatically connected, but the Radak, a great commentary on the Psalms, does make that connection. The other explanation of the word machol is a tunnel. So what we're going to see here today is we're going to start understanding forgiveness as a circle and forgiveness as a tunnel. Let's start with forgiveness as a circle. The pasuk in Tehillim, the verse in Psalm says, "Hafachta mispedi lemacholi." You have changed my mourning into dancing, v'tazreini simcha, and you girded me with happiness. So most people translate that as, "You have changed my mourning into dancing." Machol is a circle, like we said before, where people dance in a circle. But the Radak, Rav David Kimchi, again, one of the great commentators on the prophets and the writings, the scriptures, says, you have changed my lamenting into forgiveness. And he explains, what was King David, the poet, the author of the book of Psalms, saying? He writes, I was mourning over the specter of my soul perishing because of my sins. But you gladdened me by the prophet Nathan Hanavi, Nathan the prophet, who brought me good tidings and said, Gam Hashem machal lechataskha, Hashem has forgiven your sins. Salach lechataskha, I think the word is. Hashem has forgiven your sins was the message of the prophet, of Nathan, of Nathan Hanavi. And on that, David HaMelech, King David says, Hafachta mispedila macholi, you changed my mourning with a message of forgiveness. What does forgiveness have to do with the circle? When we remain angry at a person, at a family, at a community, We remove ourselves from that circle. Oh, I'm angry at the rabbi of that synagogue now, so I don't go in there. Who's on the outs? You're on the outs. Who's out of the circle? You're out of the circle. Oh, our family, we don't talk to that family anymore. Who's on the outs? You're on the outs. I don't talk to my sister anymore. Yeah, we got into a fight 7 years ago after my parents passed away. Who's on the outs? You're on the outs. You've removed yourself from the circle. But when you can come to forgive for whatever slight you believe the rabbi or your sister or that family or your wife or your husband did to you, you can bring yourself back into that circle. What is a circle? A circle is a place of equality. Everything in a circle is equidistant. You take one strip of a circle and it's equal to the exact same strip in any part of the circle. A line is not equality. A line is, there's closer and further away. You have a circle, everything is equidistant from the middle. It's a perfect shape. A circle represents equality, and it represents focus on an inner point. The greatest joy will be that in the time of Mashiach, the tzaddikim will make a circle around God. They'll all be standing equidistant from God, and they'll all be focused on that internal mission. When we hold on to bitterness and enmity, fights, we are out of the circle. And through forgiveness, mechila, we come back into the circle. If you look at a wedding, it's fascinating. The whole... A Jewish wedding is a beautiful, beautiful experience. I was just at a wedding this week. And it's very different than a secular wedding. In a secular wedding, they usually have the horror in the beginning, right? And then it usually, you know, then it goes into the regular DJ. Then they bust out the DJ or whatever it is. Think about the difference in dancing between a Jewish, like a traditional Jewish wedding and the regular dancing for most of a more secular Jewish wedding. In a traditional Jewish wedding, the entire dancing is done in circles. Everyone's together. Everyone's holding hands. Everyone's united in purpose and mission. And they're dancing around the chasen and the kala, the bride and the groom. Totally focused on the mission of making their day the most magical day possible. We're all in it together and we're all focused on the mission. Whereas in a secular wedding, as soon as the horror is done, what, they bust out the DJ, then it's everybody off to their own, doing their thing, you know? Bouncing around, back and forth, you know? A couple drinks, a little more dancing. Do the Macarena, you know? The Macarena, wow, I'm dating myself. Right? But like, there's that very, very big lack of machol, of a circle. A circle represents, again, equality and purpose. And when we give forgiveness, we are able to once again join in that circle of the family, of the community, of the relationship that we were putting ourselves out of by holding on to this anger. So that's the first idea of mechila, of forgiveness as a circle. In order to come to that, by the way, you need a lot of humility. Obviously, you're not going to ask for forgiveness if you don't have humility. Because I didn't do anything wrong. It's all their fault. It's all my sister's fault. You know what happened? After my mom passed away, they just opened up the will and she turned into an insane animal. It's all her fault. I don't have anything to do with her anymore. Nothing on you. Of course, nothing. Of course not. You're reasonable. I don't even want to get into the details. I don't even want to get into the details. So you need humility to be able to ask for forgiveness. And you need humility to grant forgiveness. Because as long as you're this perfect human being, There's very little room in your heart to understand other people's imperfections. That's also, I think, a big difference. Like, for example, in we talk about charity. Humility is a huge prerequisite for charity. Because if you believe that it was your great brilliance and your hard work that got you all your wealth, then why should you give your money away to someone else? Let them be smart about it. Let them work hard. I did it. Let them do it. If you believe that you are blessed by God who shined down his countenance and his spigot of financial success upon you, and that's why you got all this money, and you're like, wow, what a gift. I better give something back. Very different perspectives. When it comes to humility, the Rambam is very famous. Maimonides is famous for the golden path, the middle road. He highly advocates taking the middle road, life in balance. But the Rambam says there are a few traits where you're not supposed to take the middle road, where you're supposed to be an extremist, a radical. The first example is humility. You should be a radical, humble person. Radically humble. It's not enough to be humble, says Maimonides. You've got to be extremely humble. When the Torah refers to Moshe, who was considered to be the most humble person ever, which, by the way, is why he was able to get the most direct prophecy ever, the greatest prophet ever, is, of course, the most humble person. Because wherever you take up space, there's not space for God. So when you pull yourself back and you're incredibly humble, there's plenty of space for God. And what does the Torah say about Moshe? Va'ish Moshe anav ma'od mikol ha'adam. And Moshe was not just humble, very humble. Ma'od, very, very humble. And the sages tell us, ma'od ma'od havei shfal ruach. You should be very, very humble. Doesn't use that in any other traits. But when it comes to humility, it says be very, very humble. What's another? So we need that humility in order to be able to forgive. What's another thing that we need to be able to forgive? We need to have a certain level of calmness. We cannot be angry people. Another trait that Maimonides says you have to go to the extreme is to the extreme against anger. You have to be an extremely, radically calm person. Even when there's times in life that anger is, so to speak, called for to teach someone a lesson, so to speak, like your children, says the Rambam, you can show it on the outside, but on the inside, you've got to be cool and collected. Now, the Torah says an amazing thing when describing the frogs, the plague of the frogs. The Torah says, Vata'al hatzfardeya, and the frog came up. It says it in the singular. It doesn't say Vata'al hatzfardeim. Doesn't say, and the frogs came up. It says the frog came up. And there's a very famous medrash that one massive frog came out. And the Egyptians got angry. Ah, what's this frog doing here? And they beat it. And as soon as they beat it, it let out a screech and started expelling tens of thousands of little baby frogs. Ah! What? We don't want that. Hit it again. Bam. Boop. And they start getting so incensed, so enraged, they start smacking and hitting and banging on this frog until this frog expels billions of little froggies that invade the entirety of Egypt. What are they doing? Stop hitting the frog. What's wrong with you? It's not working out for you. What does Einstein say? The definition of insanity is doing the same thing again and again and expecting different results. Every time you hit the frog, it did not work out well for you. And we look at these Egyptians and we laugh with Schadenfreude. Such fools. Such fools. Guess what? We do it all the time. We do it all the time. We build up these fights, these petty fights with our friends, with our family, with our coworkers. And we watch it destroying the peace in our home. We watch it destroying the peace in our community. But we just can't stop. We see how much our relationships are getting hurt, but we can't stop. We just get angry. We hold that grudge. Well, she said this, and he said that, and she did this, and he did that. What are you doing? Is it's hurting you. You see it's hurting you. It's like the frog. Every time you get into a fight with another person, you cut them out of your life, and you this, and you that, and what's it doing for you? Where are you holding? How many friends do you have left? Just keep doing it. So we need, in order to really be able to come to that place of forgiveness, we need both the humility to ask forgiveness, the humility to understand that we too are flawed and to give forgiveness, and we need to be able to tone down our anger, because when we're in anger, we're never able to forgive. So that is the idea of forgiveness as a circle. Let's now talk about forgiveness as a tunnel. We have two people. And now there's this big event standing in between them. Something happened. He said something very offensive. He made a business deal without consulting me first with my previous partner. My roommate is dating my ex. Whatever it is. And there's this big event in between us. The idea of forgiveness as a tunnel is I lower myself a little bit below the event, you lower yourself a little bit below the event, and we do it. We come closer and inch closer and closer until we come and meet in the middle. The word again, mechila, in Hebrew also means a tunnel. Let's look at the story of Yosef and his brothers. Yosef's brothers sold him into slavery. They first planned on killing him. Then they put him in a pit and left him there. And then they sold him into slavery. Now for starters, we see something interesting. It's a very good lab for understanding forgiveness, because there are certain very unique things that happen there. Number one, Yosef is able to hear the brothers' true feelings without them speaking to him. Because they're speaking in their Hebrew, thinking that no one understands it, and Yosef understands it. And they're now standing in front of this Egyptian king, and he's being mean to them. And what do they say to each other in Hebrew? Vayomer ish el achiv, and each one said to their brother, Aval ashamim anachnu, we are guilty. Alachenu, for our brother Asher Ra'inu Tsaras Nafsho, we saw the pain of his soul, Bishanu, Aleinu, Velo Shamanu, he was crying out to us and we didn't hear. Al Kain Ba Aleinu Tsarazos, because of this, we're going through this challenge, this pain, this suffering right now. And Yosef hears that the brothers truly feel sorry. They feel guilt. Ashamim anachnu, we are guilty. What's Yosef's response? It's such a powerful thing to see the fact that the person that hurt him is in pain over the fact that they hurt him. Immediately, Vayasev me'alem vayevk, Yosef turns away from them and cries. Because he sees that they truly are pained. They truly are bowed by the weight and the guilt of what they did. And that they don't even know that he's there. Next, there's the concept of true repentance being shown by the fact that you get another opportunity to do the same thing again and you don't do it. So here, Yosef sets up this whole situation where he nabs Binyamin, who's another one of Rachel's sons, because there's a sort of almost like a power struggle, seems like, going on between the different children of the different wives of Yaakov. And he takes Binyamin, he says, I'm going to make him into a slave. You guys, you're free to go. Here's another opportunity for all the sons of Leah to skate free and leave another son of Rachel in the lurch of slavery. But this time, no, that's not what happens. Yehuda says, no, no, no. Va'ata yeshiv na avdecha tachas hanar eved la'adoni v'anar yalom achav. Yehuda steps forward and says, no, I'll take it on me this time. We're in an uncomfortable situation where one of the children of Rachel is causing us uncomfortable feelings, but I'm going to take it this time. I'm not going to pass the buck and leave one of Rachel's children in the lurch. And again, Yosef is crying. And at that point, he says, everyone get out of the room. He's crying and he cries out to the brothers and to Yosef. And he's, again, because he feels the pain of the brothers for what they did wrong. And he's able to bring himself lower again. And finally, the last stage is after Yaakov dies, when the brothers come and they convey to him how deeply ashamed they are of what they did through saying what Yaakov had said. And again, Yosef turns away and weeps. Yosef was the victim. But Yosef over here is getting a very strong feeling for what the other person is emotion. He's getting a good emotional read on his brothers. He's feeling their pain. He's feeling their guilt. And he's willing to acknowledge that. And he's crying from it. He's empathetic to their pain. Again, he's empathetic to the pain of the aggressor. That's tunneling. That's where he's going down to try to meet them. And of course, they are going through this pain too. And they beg him for forgiveness. They throw themselves at his feet and beg him for forgiveness. So that's one step that we see is a really important component of forgiveness. Being able to get that emotional window into what the aggressor felt. Where are they coming from? Maybe when they were a child in their home, a wife doesn't understand why her husband seems emotionally distant. A husband doesn't understand why his wife seems emotionally distant. And maybe they need to look and look at their families. Maybe they grew up in a home that was emotionally distant. Excuse me. They just don't have that model. Maybe they grew up in a home where there was a lot of anger, a lot of power struggles. Let me understand where you're coming from, and I can cry with you, as opposed to just being angry at you. Another thing, Yosef says to the brothers, when they originally say to him, we're so sorry, he says, listen, you intended me harm. V'ha'elokim chashava l'tova, and Hashem made it good, so that I could keep everybody alive here. I'm the viceroy of Egypt. I'm keeping a huge percentage of the world alive today. Yes, you had a bad intention, but there was some silver lining there. Yosef is able to reframe the offense and find something that he can pull out of it. Can we find any sort of thread of something to hold on to make it better? It says that when the brothers were coming back from burying their father in Israel, at some point they became very afraid, and again they throw themselves down at Yosef's feet and they're begging him for forgiveness. What made them afraid? Yosef turned off of the road. They're traveling back from Israel now, back to Egypt. And Yosef turns off of the road to where the pit where his brothers threw him into. And they're thinking, he's going to throw us in. He's the king now. He's the king. He's got all the army. He's got everything. He's going to take us back here to the place where we wronged him. What does he want to do to us? But no. When he gets to the pit, he stands over the pit that his brothers threw him into. And he says, Baruch she'asah li nes b'makom hazeh. Blessed is God who made a miracle for me in this place, because this pit was filled with snakes and scorpions and nothing happened to me. That is someone who's able to take even the most offensive offense and turn it around, find the silver lining. God showed me a strength I never knew I had. God showed me his incredible providence in this place. So let's talk about some practical tips from the world of psychology to getting to forgiveness. In psychology, there's something called fundamental attribution error. And this is where there's a fundamental difference in how we understand events. When you do something wrong, what's the default setting? You understand it in the context of something else that was going on at the time or some external circumstance. I was really tired. You know, I had just gotten really bad news that my dog got, you know, sick. I wasn't myself. That's our fundamental default. When we do something, even though we recognize it's wrong, we recognize it's wrong. If we're arrogant, we don't recognize it's wrong, it's one thing. But let's say we're not. Let's say we understand. I really messed up over there. Our default is I was under pressure, I was embarrassed, I was in pain, I was tired, I was hungry, I was whatever it is. However, interestingly, the default, when someone else does something wrong to me, what's our default? It's a problem with them. Right? And that's what we call the fundamental attribution error. Is that I always, fundamentally, I attribute the things I do wrong to some external circumstance that was operating that day. But when it's my friend who did something wrong, I attribute it to them being a bad person. He's just, whatever, he's just a bad guy. I can't deal with him. He's selfish, he's lazy, he's careless, he's insensitive. When the Torah says, "V'ahavta l'reacha kamocha," love others like yourself, you give yourself enough love that you can find ways to overlook your own transgressions, even when you know you did wrong. But you're able to, deep down, your default is, it wasn't that I'm a bad person, it's that I did this because of X, Y, and Z. Love your neighbor like yourself. When someone offends you, try to find that same way you would describe that thing if it was happening, you were the one who did it. Next, there's a doctor named Dr. Janice Abrams Spring, and she's a therapist who specializes in the psychology of forgiveness, and she describes two kinds of people. First of all, there's cheap forgiveness. Cheap forgiveness is you get offended by someone, they really did something wrong to you, and then you're like, okay, don't worry about it, I forgive you, don't worry about it, it's okay. But you say it right away without any kind of real, any movement on the other person's part. That's cheap forgiveness. And you probably don't mean it. You just don't feel comfortable being in a fight setting, so you want to get out of it as fast as possible. Oh, it's okay, I forgive you, I really do, don't worry about it. You say that all the time, you find yourself saying that all the time. And you don't really mean it, which really means that you're building up resentment inside. It's cheap forgiveness, because it doesn't really work. It's ersatz. It's like possum, postum instead of coffee. It just doesn't do the trick. There's no tunneling, there's no trying to get to meet the other person, there's no trying to get back in the circle. They're just like, yeah, you're forgiven. Don't worry about it. It's okay. Then there's the other person. Oh. There's another person called the injustice collector. The injustice collector. They just don't forgive. They don't forgive. You do something wrong, they're going to hold it against you forever and ever. And you could say you're sorry 5 times. And I got to tell you, it's very interesting. I had a personal experience with a guy. This guy's a heart of gold, but he had a very tough life. His father died when he was very young. He felt the whole responsibility of supporting his mother and his sister. And he worked incredibly hard. And he's got some character challenges. And for whatever reason, he felt like I'd wronged him. This past summer, he called me about something, and he didn't like the way I responded. And I apologized. I did not mean it at all in a way to get offensive. And I explained to him that. And I apologized a few times, but he was just holding on. I'm like, you know what? Can't do it. You know, that's it. I just kind of let it go. I'm not going to, what do you want me to do? You want me to kneel down and kiss your ring? Like, you're an injustice collector. I'm sorry. I didn't intend it in the first place, and I truly didn't. Like, I ain't no saint, but there are times when I know I did something wrong, clearly. And there are times where, like, I know what I said to him, and I can recount the conversation, and I did recount the conversation a million times, and I said, I even said, look, if you were offended, I'm sorry that you came out offended. Like, but he wouldn't let it go. I'm like, okay, I'm not letting it. I'm just going to walk. I kind of left. He ended up calling me a few months later. And it was funny, actually. A whole other thing happened. He's blown the top again. I tried to steer him some business. It didn't work out. He claims that I should be working harder. I'm like, I did it. I tried. it's, you know, you're an injustice collector. So what do we do? How do we become, on one hand, we don't want to be a cheap forgiver. On the other hand, we don't want to become an injustice collector. We don't want to just forgive when we don't really forgive, and we don't want to not forgive when we should be forgiving. So what do? We have a conversation. And the first fundamental key to that conversation is strike when the iron is cold. Do not strike when the iron is hot. When you're 15 minutes, 20 minutes after this conversation just happened, and you feel totally offended, and this person feels totally defensive, it's the wrong time. Wait until after the inauguration ceremony. No, I'm kidding. We have to give it time. We have to give it time and then schedule a conversation. Say to the person, you know, let's talk. We had a disagreement. Things got heated. When can we sit down and talk about it? So this point, the person is thinking about it as they're getting up to the time where you're going to have this conversation. And then you have the conversation. Here's one of the dynamics that can work for a planned conversation. This is a very useful tool for any type of conflict resolution. It can be between spouses, it can be between parents and children, it can be between coworkers, it can be between a lot of different groups. Number one, so you have a time scheduled. So everyone knows ahead of time, they're sort of thinking about what they want to do, and the day is coming up to this conversation. If they have a place scheduled, and the place should preferably be a place with very little distractions. You don't want to meet somebody in a crowded restaurant or bar where there's, you know, music and TVs and people and talking. Ideally, you should both leave your phones at the door. It's very little distractions. Then we have what's called the speaker-listener technique, which is not simply I speak and you listen and then you speak and I listen, because then what often ends up happening is while I'm speaking, what are you doing? You're preparing your rebuttal, right? As I'm speaking and describing what happened, you are already preparing your rebuttal. That's not a great thing. The way the speaker-listener technique works is that while I'm speaking, I'm supposed to speak for a very short amount of times and use, you know, maybe two or three sentences at a time and not describe what you did. Talk about how I felt, right? And use a few sentences at a time, and then the listener has to repeat it back to me. Paraphrased, how they understood what I just said, because maybe they didn't understand what I just said. Often there's that miscommunication. I said X and you heard Y. So this way, you, while I'm speaking, you have to be listening because you're about to paraphrase it back to me. You can't be thinking about your rebuttal, and that is not the opportunity for your rebuttal. So I'm going to say, I felt incredibly hurt when last week, in front of the whole entire lunch and learn, you smashed me in the face. And instead of you saying, but you deserved it because you supported, you have to say, oh, I hear what you're saying. You're saying you felt embarrassed and hurt physically because I hit you in the face. Ah, good. There we go. We're making ground over here, right? So that's the speaker-listener technique. It's not that you just listen. It's that when you listen, you're actually actively listening because you got to paraphrase it back to me. And then we keep it. I, the speaker, say a few sentences about how I felt. You repeat it back to me. I say a few more. You repeat it back to me. And then when I'm done, you start. That's the speaker-listener technique. Next, curiosity. Trying to understand what the other person was feeling when they did what was offensive to you. Instead of just focusing on how you felt, try to understand and ask the other person, what were you thinking? What was your feelings? What made you say that? Try to understand what led up to that, and try to understand what led up to your extreme reaction to that. And last but not least is relative contribution, being able to recognize that usually, almost in every single argument, in every single environment, there's more than just 100% blame being assigned to one person. It's called relative contributions. Yes, I was wrong for what I did. But there was a level, if we can both come to a place where we both recognize that we both had a little bit to play here, then we're in much better shape. As the great saying goes, a clear conscience is sometimes simply a sign of a bad memory. So that is the main ideas that we're going to talk about for today. Next week, I think we have a Hanukkah special, which will be very special. And hopefully, again, we can come to a place of forgiveness. If there's anybody that you feel that you've really kind of kept yourself out of a circle for a while, maybe consider giving them a call and saying, let's have a conversation in a few days' time. And really try to make that, close that gap, close that circle, tunnel beneath the offense, and get to a place of understanding together. And with that, I conclude. Thank you very much, and have a wonderful day.